Isaac.
Good morning.
Thank you.
designate it fully for one or the other, then it'll go all to that one. Also, they're going to be matched by money from our, what do you call that fund?
Endowment.
Mission endowment.
Yeah. Mission endowment. Okay. I mentioned that fund different times to other pastors or other churches, and they're just amazed that you people have set money aside from some special receipts for that. And that is a nice thing. Also, on the Tuesday, the 26th, we're going to be joining North Highland for Thanksgiving services. It's 2 days ahead of Thanksgiving, but we've discovered that the eve of Thanksgiving, people like to stay home.
Is that at North Highland?
At North Highland, yeah. I think they were there last year, too. It seems to me we were gone last year. We've been invited to be gone this year, but I don't think I better do that because Lou might boycott me altogether if I did that. So. But we don't know. In this day and age of instant messaging, instant communication, people usually wait till the last minute, last instant to let you know what their plans are, as opposed to long-range plan. Any other announcements, any other concerns, issues, Art?
Just want to remind people again to take those calendars. They start December 1st. And on those calendars, there are scripture readings on them. In December, they're easy. It's like two verses a day. Kind of a nice warm up if anybody plans to read the scripture in the year. And then in January, it starts getting to 4 or 5 chapters at a time. So if you're looking for a Bible plan, get through the Bible, or at least most of the Bible in the year, those calendars are good. But nice, easy warm up in December, two verses a day.
They get a run out of December. Yeah. Good idea. All right. Okay, well, let's stand and take a few minutes and move out. We're going to welcome each other to this time.
Thank you.
My favorites too.
I tried singing the melody the first time through. I thought, I don't know the melody all that well. I think I'll just go to the basement again and sing down there. So, okay, let's take these next several moments and spend them in prayer. Eternal God, we pray for those who are ill and in distress, those who are lost in body and spirit. And we pray for healing of body and spirit, for strength to move ahead, especially with life struggles. God of mercy, this day we ask for blessings
of the height jokes.
That's not where I was going.
I know.
Now, actually, I was going to, we're going to do I'll Fly Away, and I think we should probably dedicate this to Lori and her family, because they've had a rough few months here. So, anyway, this goes out to Lori. Yard that ought to be cleaned up, and the shed is full of really bad stuff that needs cleaning.
said something in a couple of weeks. I wonder if he's going to say, aha, you didn't listen to me, did you?
He did something.
But what's done is done. The art of doing nothing. But doing nothing, I think, can be real valuable if you do something like reflect and pray and think, evaluate, and not have to feel like you have to get up and solve every one of your late projects or anything in record speed. And this actually plugs in for what we're going to talk about. In Matthew, Jesus spoke of the time when he would come in. His hearers likely thought, hey, sounds good to us. I mean, these last few months have been kind of gruesome. They've given up their work, they've abandoned the routine claims of daily life to sit back and wait in excited idleness for Christ to come again. In Paul's letter to the Thessalonians, he says that they had the wrong idea about the second coming. In effect, he said, you're playing hooky from work, from family, from life itself, and you do nothing but wait. That's the message translation. Be alert, for you don't know the day your Lord is coming. Jesus said we're not to hand about Jesus said we're not to hang about with those who are lazy and refuse to work. We showed you how to pull your weight when we were with you, so get on with it. We didn't sit around on our hands expecting others to take care of us. In fact, we worked our fingers to the bone up half the night, moonlighting, so you wouldn't be burdened with taking care of us. It isn't that we don't appreciate your support. We do. We simply wanted to provide an example of diligence, hoping it would prove contagious. Friends, don't slack off in doing your duty, your faith tasks. He tells the young church at Thessalonica that all his life he worked with his hands. Jewish society said, he who does not teach his son a trade teaches him to steal. A little harsh, but not completely untrue. Paul was a rabbi. Jewish law said rabbis must take no pay for teaching, but have a trade and pay for their daily needs with their labor. So rabbis were bakers, barbers, carpenters, masons, and all kinds of trades. Honest toil had dignity. Scholars lost something when they were so academic and withdrawn from life they forgot how to work with their hands. One of the interesting things when I was working summer jobs, you know, when I was in college, we got to work for a construction company out of Selby, Delzer Construction. And there was a guy in that work crew that summer, was about 5'1 or 2, wiry, strong, and he did not like college boys, not one bit. And we had three of us who were in college and one who had married a farmer's daughter, and he was trying to prove everybody he could smoke a pipe, which he couldn't do. And he was wasting a lot of time lighting this stupid pipe. Now, I like pipes. My grandfather smoked one, and until the Surgeon General says, don't do that, so he quit, which was kind of a surprise. But this kid kept lighting this pipe, and it kept going out. And so when the time came to trim the crew back, he was one of the first ones to go. And then another one of our friends left, and two of us were left there for a long time. But Frank, the little guy, actually came around to where he seemed to kind of like us. And I think that worked in my favor when I backed over his toolbox of his truck and didn't get killed. But one of the guys said, you know, you're lucky. He said, no, I said, I just went up to Frank and said, you're going to find out sooner or later, might as well be now. I just backed over your toolbox with your truck. And so he walks up and he says, well, by golly, you did. And he walked off whistling, hey, happy Arab. I figured, well, I'm probably safe. He didn't think any college kids were worth too much because they didn't seem to know how to work with their hands. And when they did have a job that took some work, they seemed to stand around a lot. My grandfather said, well, that was because they were practicing to work for the city. Grandpa Keenan didn't have any great use for highly educated kids that didn't know much. And he didn't have much for city workers either, but they did keep the streets smooth. And he drove on the streets. I never told him that because he would have appreciated that either. Paul says, you know, this business of not working doesn't really have anything to do with the unfortunate who, through no fault of their own, can't work, injuries or whatever. Jesus learned carpentry from his father. And I always thought that was kind of interesting. Jesus was a carpenter. Both my grandfathers were in carpentry. I used to worry about when I built something. I was talking to my grandmother one day. I said, you know, if Grandpa saw that work that I did on that thing, he would just be probably ashamed of me. She said, well, why? Well, it's just kind of crude. She says, Jack, relax. Your grandfather hated finishing work. Just hated it. He liked structural stuff. Do it. Do it fast. Get it done right and move on. Let somebody else do the fussy stuff. He had no idea how much comfort that gave. A simple thing. Jesus learned carpentry from his father. It's interesting. My dad could hardly drive a nail. In some place I got this carpentry thing. Probably from his grandfather. A man bought a house one time without even seeing it. And somebody says, good grief, what are you, crazy? He says, no. He said, I know the man who built that house. He builds his faith in with bricks. He's an honorable man. Christians should be more conscientious in their work than anyone else. That's the lesson of that one. Those who do their work as best they can have little time for frivolity, like trying to keep your pipe lit when you don't know how to do it. Much less gossiping about what their neighbors do or ought to be doing. There are greater sins than gossip, but none does more damage to the church. And the Music Man, which came out, I think, when I was in the Brookings in school for a year, Professor Harold Hill was the Music Man. Came to this little town in Iowa, and was an opportunist and flim-flam man. He could charm. You know, like somebody said, he could sell lawnmowers, Eskimos, or, you know, people. Anyhow, he was going down the main street of this little town in Iowa and saw this big wagon backed up by the local tavern. And they were unloading a pool table. And he goes into this whole spiel about pool. And we don't have to go through that whole song, but it's really good. But at one point he says in the song, idle hands are the devil's playground. Which is what a lot of people thought. Even excited idleness could be said to be dangerous. Waiting for the second coming leaves too much time for such deviltry as gossip. Things have changed a lot. When I moved to Myrtle, Wayne Teason was the pastor there, and we went out and looked at the house and stuff. In the basement, he had a pool table. I said, whoa, a pool table? I've always wanted a pool table. He says, tell you what, $500, it's yours. I said, I don't want to move that thing. I don't play pool. So I bought it. Which was fine because I didn't have to move it in there. But when we left Myrtle, took that sucker apart, loaded it in a semi, piece by piece by piece, and the more pieces you loaded, the heavier it got. Got it up to Britain, and there was a guy in our church whose folks had owned a pool hall, and he helped me put it together. And when we got it together, it wasn't straight in the room, and he got underneath and he lifted it himself. He guidance than to severe reprimand, haven't you? I mean, if somebody chews on you and calls you names or insults your intelligence or whatever, the last thing you're really interested in is finding out if you can learn something from them. Now, not all of those are lost, but that's not a good way to start, I think. We had an interesting thing in our home. My mother was always the first one to decide if I was doing something that wasn't quite right. And when my dad would come home, she'd say, "Tyler, you got a blah, 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 blah." And he'd say, "Oh, for gosh sakes, you know, why do I get these spots anyway?" But he finally just told her one time, "If you're having a problem with Jack, you settle it." So I don't want to be coming home and be the heavy all the time. He didn't use quite those words, but it was something like that. I remember those things. It was, of course, not perfectly. I have had my, well, you know, I still have those moments when I don't get into the discipline thing very well. Yesterday, when we called the ambulance, two really nice people came over and they assessed the situation and got Kathy loaded up. And after she was in the ambulance and things, Watson was running around the house, around and around and around, barking his fool head off. He's got the most obnoxious bark, just on and on and on. And I said, "Watson, no, shut up, no," you know, things like that, and on. Finally, it dawned on me, something's not right. So instead of speaking loudly or saying much at all, I just sat down. And he jumped in my lap. Anger produces more resentment than reform or discipleship. Christian discipline is to be given always in love. But he was going around the room, sniffing at these different smells, these different people, still learned how to love, how to make his daily work and all he does at home and work and play each day to be seen as obviously guided by faith and the love of God and Jesus Christ. I don't know what it was exactly, but these uncles that I was telling you about, the one never talked about anything. He was kind of like that Norwegian bachelor farmer who loved his wife so much he almost told her. Now, we knew that he loved my Aunt Jean, but man, get that guy to talk about anything? He was an ag engineer over at SDSU. Nice, nice guy. One of the other ones was in the Marines in the South Pacific. And the other one was at the Army in North Africa, Italy, France. They were all really good men. They seemed to appreciate every day they lived. And I wonder sometimes if some of that wasn't strengthened by the time in combat. They might have learned from service and some from survival the value of life and the need to live it more significantly. Serving in service to other people. They did really wonderful things. Remember, years some I don't know how long ago it was now, but I ran across this thing and just a blurb I'd seen in a journal or someplace that said that this church
for you.
Okay.
How did the symphony go?
It went really